Hello, everyone. I am Ben Johnson, and this is the Perpetual Chess Podcast. Perpetual Chess is a weekly chess interview show where we talk with accomplished chess players, authors, and personalities about their lives, their careers, and how to improve at chess. Perpetual Chess is brought to you through the generosity of its Patreon and PayPal supporters and by Chessable.com. Happy New Year, everyone, and welcome back to another Adult Improver edition of Perpetual Chess. For those who have not heard these before, we bring in someone who has accomplished a lot in the realm of improving at chess as a non-chess professional. And my guest this week is a longtime internet friend of mine and many others, especially in the Twitter chess community. He is a 34-year-old father of three based in Denmark, works as an archivist in the Library of the Danish Parliament. He's gained a few hundred points in the past few years. After a long plateau, he went from about 1,600 to 1,800 FIDE, and he's been grinding hard during the quarantine period. So he's gotten his Lee Chess Classical rating up to 2,200. Now, of course, we don't know exactly what that translates to in a FIDE rating, but I'm pretty confident it's over 1,800. So making great strides despite many demands on his time, including he's an active blogger, writes about chess and his chess improvement study methods a ton on his blog, which of course I'll link to for you guys. And he's out with a new book, a much needed book, which is really a gift to the chess improvement community. It is called Blindfold Endgame Visualization, 50 Chess Positions. And we'll be talking about the book and everything else in due time. But first, let's bring him in. So Martin Justesen, thank you for finally joining the show.
Thank you, Ben. It's an honor to be invited to a show, and I'm really looking forward to it. So thank you, and thank you for a nice introduction. It's really nice of you.
My pleasure. And you're one of these adult improver guests, Martin, that the main thing I'll be doing is asking you about 20 different ways how you find time to do all the stuff you do, because it's quite impressive.
Yeah.
So, but before we start doing that, why don't you tell us a little bit about your chess background? So I know you sent me a few biographical notes and that you played your first tournament at 21. So why don't we dive in there?
Yeah.
How did that come about?
I've always been interested in games, and especially computer gaming took up a huge part of my youth, strategy games and stuff like that. But at my late teens, I got interested in poker and played it with my friends. And then about 18, 19, I started playing poker online. But I didn't really want to take any risks, so I played the limit poker, micro stakes, and I didn't have any money to lose. And eventually, I got bored with playing poker online, even though I was very methodical and bought, I think it was Doyle Brunson's giant poker book.
Super system, yeah.
Yeah, I think if I remember correctly, you have also played some poker.
Yes, but we won't let it derail the chess conversation.
Let's No.
Keep it to chess.
but I got bored with the poker, and while playing, I suddenly drifted to a World Chess Championship coverage by Yasser, who covered the World Championship in 2005, I think, at Chess Base. I really, it caught my interest, and I started playing online at the Chess Base internet site that time. And then not that long after, I joined a club. It was there the journey started for me. I really, really enjoyed it was really exciting to go into a chess club, I remember, and a bit frightening also, because I was very green and didn't. I hadn't played any chess in my childhood. As many of the previous adult improvers, I think, had some relationship with the game. While my only experience with the game was learning the rules from my dad, but we never played it much. So I was not used to any of the culture of the game and had to learn all the formalities also. But that's where I started.
That's interesting. So I feel like you're probably one of the first people that discovered chess online and became a tournament player there. Obviously now I'm sure there's people listening who, you know, whether it be from Queen's Gambit or from watching Twitch or YouTube or whatever it may be, that and just playing on chess.com and Lee Chess and Chess24 and all the sites. I'm sure that's how a lot of people who are listening got hooked. But back in 2005, it wasn't quite as easy. I mean, Internet Chess Club was the primary place for playing, although I think maybe the chess base site, at least now, I think it's called playchess.com.
Yeah.
But I know that they had a site as well, but I haven't talked to as many people who, like, that was their hook at that time, and only later did they get to meet people. So what was it like the first time you went to meet people and actually play chess? Were you nervous?
Yeah, I was quite nervous because I didn't know anybody in the club, so I just walked into the door and said hello, I was quite young compared to the rest of the guys in the club. Many old timers playing the game for many years, and there was still smoking, and after 9 o'clock, the pipes were lit, if I remember correctly, so.
And where was this in Denmark?
It was in Roskilde. It's okay. 20 kilometers from Copenhagen.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then when did you play your first tournament, Martin?
I think it was 21, and I got after the first tournament, I was rated 1400 Danish rating,
which is pretty comparable to USCF and FIDE, from what I understand.
Yeah, I think Danish rating is pretty close to FIDE rating. It relates pretty closely to that. And today, my Danish rating is also around my FIDE rating.
Okay. That's pretty good for a first rating, 1400. Were you reading books, or was it just that you'd played a lot by then, or what do you think
led to that? I pretty quickly bought. I think it was because of it, I was spellbinded by Yasser, and I bought his book, "Play Winning Chess" or something like that. And also I bought. Logical Chess by Irving Chenev.
Yeah, great choices, actually. His Yasser Seirawan's Winning Chess series is a great sort of primer, and I recommend Logical Chess move by move all the time, even though the analysis isn't perfect, but it's more important just to have the ideas explained.
I think there were pretty good choices, and then I also bought some chess DVDs from the Chess Base store. Carsten Müller's Endgames,
that's serious stuff there. Carsten Müller doesn't mess around with the Endgames.
A bit dry, I would say, but you can't put a spot on anything wrong with it. So,
So how often were you playing, and how often were you studying once you dove in in those years?
It was while I was studying history at the Copenhagen University, and I was playing once a week chess in the chess club. But same time, I had my studies, and I think in that period I was also I went to a lot of parties and and had another life that you have when you're young without kids. So I didn't take chess as serious back then. So it was, I think it was like a hobby I had besides everything else. But I definitely didn't take it as serious as I try to do now.
And so when did that switch for you? When did you decide you were going to take it seriously?
I think it's been gradual, but I think it was in the last 2 or 3 years, I've been more serious about how I spend time on chess and how I study chess. And I think also that explains why I had a pretty long plateau on the 1600 rating level. Because I played the normal club tournaments every Tuesday, and then I looked at some books and some videos maybe, and then I also did other stuff, and then there went some times where I didn't play chess, and then I came back to it.
So basically, you stopped having fun, stopped going to parties, and then you started getting better at chess.
Yeah, I started having kids.
Yeah, well, the having kids usually doesn't help so much, but the partying and having fun.
Yeah, I can think back and look at how I used my time back then and think, oh, why didn't I use my time more wisely or manage my time better back then, because I had so much time compared to now.
So I feel the same way, Martin. Trust me. So
advice to all you guys and girls who study chess and don't have any kids yet, then now is the is the time to go full throttle.
Yeah, I was giving that exact advice earlier today. It gets exponentially harder to carve out the time, and I feel it's hard to understand until you're in it. You know, I mean, you get the whatever. You either know or you don't if you're listening. But suffice to say, it's good advice. So Martin, I want to get into more to what you do studying. But first, let's take a break and hear from our friends at aimchess.com. This episode is brought to you in part by aimchess.com, a new sponsor with a great new product that collects all your games from Lee Chess and chess.com and gives you reports of what you need to work on. They even have a new free 2020 recap report that gives you an overview of your chess highlights for the year. So it's pretty fun stuff. They have a free version as well as a subscription one. So you should go check out the site, see if you like it. And then if you decide to subscribe, be sure to use the promo code CHESS30. Capitalization does not matter, and that will show them that you came from Perpetual Chess and you liked what you saw. Okay, back to the interview. Check out aimchess.com. And we are back and we are ready to dive into what Martin has done to lead to these improvements that he's made. Now, but first I'd like to talk a little bit about your blog, Martin, because you've been blogging and you're active on Chess Twitter with all of your study methods. So once you got serious, could you describe sort of the evolution of how you approach chess improvement over these past few years?
Yeah, definitely. I think it all started I somehow discovered Twitter in 2007, and I have never used Twitter before that. I had one of those Excel's profiles for a long time, but then I discovered that there was a chess community on Twitter, and I got inspired by a lot of other players wanting to improve, and also I can mention also one I got inspired by Stjepan.
Stjepan is hanging pawns on YouTube, and for listeners, if you haven't been through the whole archive yet, he did a good adult improvement interview himself, and his YouTube videos are great. But so go on, Martin.
Yeah, definitely check that episode out and his YouTube channel, and it also inspired me to start making content, making a blog, and also eventually making a YouTube channel. And I think sharing the journey has helped me stay motivated and and also try to annotate my games, which I didn't really do before a long period where I didn't really make any rating improvement. The most the method I did, I played a lot of correspondence chess on chess.com. I think I've played about 1,300 correspondence games through the years on chess.com, and also a lot of blitz games on chess.com. But I decided to try to play longer games and annotate the games as well, and that was a starting point.
Yeah, and the correspondence games, chess.com also refers to them as the daily games. Obviously, you just move when you log in, and it's a great way to play a sort of slower game than the Blitz one. So Martin, when you were annotating these games, how much time were you spending on annotating them, and were you using the engine to do it or just doing it on your own?
I've tried both things. I've tried to do it without the engine and tried with the engine, and I found that I feel like I'm not strong enough to completely trust myself without using the engine to check my own evaluations. So when I have a lot of time and energy, I like to first go through the games myself and go through the variations, and then afterwards turn off the engine. But I would be lying if I didn't admit that that I also sometimes just have the engine running while I'm annotating the games. But I feel like that's a bit more if I don't have as much time, I would pick that option. But I would recommend doing it the first way.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm guilty of having the engine on at times too, but definitely it's good to try to journal your thoughts as best you can. Yeah. So we've got a couple questioners from Patreon supporters, Martin. They've been slacking up until this week over the past few weeks, but when it's time for an adult improver interview, it's always good to get some questions, and we have a few. So the first is from supporter of the podcast, Mark Miller. Mark, thank you for the support. And Mark has gotten back into chess in recent years after a long time, you know, working as a lawyer and having a family, I believe, and all that stuff. But he finds his openings are kind of a train wreck, which I can relate to. So Martin says, during the course of your improvement from a FIDE 1800 player to where you are now, which again, we don't know exactly where, but we think it's above 1800. Have your openings or opening preparation involved in any way? And if so, how?
Yeah, I would say I've done many things with my openings, and I've for a long period of time I played the London system with white, and played the French with black, and also the Semislav, and I've then and I picked openings that I tried to minimize the complexity and how much time I should put in, especially with the London system, because I think that's an opening you can rather quickly play and not spend too much time. But in recent years, there's evolving even also a lot of theory that you need to know. And so I have also picked other openings, and I've used Chessable to study, and I bought some of the opening courses, but I've also been very happy just to use the short and sweet courses that they put out, just to get a feeling of the openings and learn those lines. And sometimes it's enough for me. I'm a not believer in spending too much time on the opening, but I can see that maybe I should put a little bit more structure into the opening studies if I want to advance further. But I don't see I'm getting into a lot of problems in the opening, so I don't think I should use all my study time on memorizing lines at my current stage.
Yeah, that was the main advice I gave to Mark in my reply to him. I just said, look at your games, and if the opening is getting you in trouble, then clearly you need to work on it. But don't, you know, you shouldn't necessarily feel some sort of like peer pressure or external pressure to study openings for their own sake. The short and sweet courses that you mentioned from Chessable, those are the free versions. Those are like an amazing resource. And obviously, I'm happy to have Chessable support on the podcast, but that's just my heartfelt opinion. I mean, there's no other comparable resource that's basically like a free mini book that really gives you an overview of an opening. But let's get a little more granular. Sorry, go ahead.
And I can also add that what I've said, when I've annotated the games and put them on my blog, I've tried to categorize them by my the opening I played in, and by doing this, I can see, okay, do I get any problems in this opening, and what do I need to learn next game in this opening line? And I think that's a great way to gradually learn an opening better. I also use the openingtree.com, I think it is, or org, as a way to just, it's a site where you can, which downloads your games from Lightchess or chess.com, and then you can jump in and see how you do in different lines. And I think also I've used that to see, okay, which lines do I far badly in, and what do I need to work on so I can use my time the best way possible.
Yeah. I just discovered openingtree.com the other day. Yeah, it's pretty cool. So what percentage of your study time would you say you're devoting to openings?
I would say I would use maybe 1 hour to 2 hours a week on opening studies
in some out of how many?
Yeah, I think it's the COVID situation has changed my daily routines quite a bit, because before COVID I was commuting to work a lot. And I would use the commuting time to study chess. So that was about one and a half hour each day for 5 days a week. And then I also studied in the evenings or played chess. But now I'm working a lot from home. So by minimizing the commuting time, I'm actually studying less chess. Right. So, on the positive side, I have a little bit more time with my family since I'm not using the train for work. So, I've tried to study more in the evening then. But it's sometimes it's hard when you are tired and focused on serious studies.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah, and it's funny how everyone's routine got changed by COVID. Sometimes it leads to more study time, sometimes less. But I still want you still got to nail this down for Mark Martin. So, what percentage, if you're doing an hour or two per week on openings? And I know it can be a little bit hard to divide, because like when you're looking at your games, as you say, you're kind of learning about the opening, but that could also be counted as game analysis. But if you were to estimate, you know, Cyrus Lakdawala recommended when I interviewed him a couple months back, devote a third of your time to openings, a third of your time to tactics, a third of your time to game analysis. And I've been kind of running with that as advice, because I think it's good. It's good enough, you know, like no one knows what's perfect, but to me, it's like, it sounds reasonable. And then you can tweak it based on what you like to do from there. I often say to newer players, spend a little less time on openings, and as you get more advanced, it might come up. But But I digress. The question is, how much time, what percentage of your time studying would you say is devoted to openings?
I would say 10 to 20%.
Okay, so that's pretty small.
Yeah, because I think I have been putting quite a big emphasis on playing chess and playing longer games. I think I ran the numbers for this year, and I have been playing about 40 or 50 minutes of chess each day, on average. Okay. So that's a good chunk of time I've. And then I've also used time on analyzing those games. So a lot of focus on playing actually games. And I haven't played much Blitz, which is one of the habits I've been working a lot on to minimize.
Yeah. Cool. That's good advice. And yeah, last thing for Mark, I would just say definitely resist the temptation to spend extra time. And Mark actually mentioned he doesn't like studying openings. It's just he feels like he knows so little at this point. So I would say it's more just about committing for a long period of time and just putting in the time every day. And like I was in Mark's situation even not that long ago, even six months ago, around when quarantine started, I was finally like, okay, I'm going to stop playing these crap openings that I've been, you know, playing for 20 years. Had to give up the Accelerated Dragon. Apologies, but the Meroxy is just too tough. I 6 months later, I don't feel like my openings are a weakness. And I probably was spending about half my time on it. So that's aggressive. Mm. So, but Mark, I definitely wouldn't recommend spending like half, 50% at the absolute most. And Martin certainly provides an example that you can get away with less. But we've got another opening question from another Patreon supporter. So let's get to this one. It is by Arjun, and I lost the question. There we go. Arjun Duvopov. And I hope I said your name somewhat correctly, Arjun. And he says, I really enjoy your blog. What resource do you use for studying master games as the same in the same openings as your training games? Are you looking for annotated games or just a database? And how did you construct your opening repertoire? Did you use advice from others or just play what you like? Do you think us age 30 plus players should avoid very sharp stuff and go for more solid practical openings? So a lot of questions in there.
Okay. And thank you for the comments on my blog. I appreciate it. I don't either like studying openings a lot. So and I've picked openings that should be easy to learn. And and maybe you can say, give me a hint on the question again, and there was quite long question.
Sure. So first question is, what resource do you use for studying master games in the same opening as your training games?
Yeah, I've used chessgames.com as a resource. It's a bit dated, but I think it's useful. And I also have the chess base on my computer, but I don't know. It's quite heavy to start up and filter everything. And so I think it's quicker just to go to chess games and there are bundles on each openings already sorted by helpful players where you can just dive in and look through some master games. That's one thing I've done. And I've also tried. I've also in my studies gone through game collections and I've always been very fascinated by Bobby Fischer. So I went through his complete game collection by Carsten Müller and just skimming through a couple of games once in a while. It's maybe because I'm not an E4 player, but I thought it was really interesting to just go through all these games.
Yeah, his games have a clarity that's pretty rare. I love to study his games as well. And so the next part of our Arjun's question was, how did you construct your opening repertoire?
Yeah, and I must admit, I'm not very structured in that way of having files. And I've tried to make the files, but then when I'm halfway through making the files, I decide to play something else. And so I'm not that methodical that I have managed to do that. I did a video with Kostya Kowiutsky from the Chess Studio and on how to make an opening file from scratch. I think that's up on the Dojo Patreon page if you want to check it out. But there we went through all the details of how to do it. But from there and to do it yourself, it takes a lot of patience and a lot of work to make these files. And I'm not convinced that for a player of my level, it's worth doing.
Yeah, that's always a question. So yeah, just to be clear about what Martin's referring to, our friends at Chess Dojo, who we've mentioned before, and of course they've all been on the show. I am Kostya Kowiutsky, GM Jesse Cry. I am David Pruse. They have their own Patreon page in which Kostya and Martin made a video talking about how they construct an opening repertoire and, you know, how you could use ChessBase for it. Of course, our friends at Chessable also, in addition to all the courses they sell, you can upload your own repertoire and just do spaced repetition to learn your own repertoire from there. I know my friend, I am Greg Shahade, he's a big advocate of doing that. And he has a like super long 90-minute YouTube video of his own talking about how he does that. But I mean, of course, we're talking in so much depth about openings, but I do want to reiterate that doesn't mean that should be the only thing that one studies. It's so easy to just sort of, I mean, there's always something to work on. So it's so easy to just get bogged down with that. But there, you do need to work on, one does need to work on other aspects of the game as well. Okay, last part of Arjun's question was, do you think us 30-plus players, age 30-plus, should avoid very sharp stuff and go for more solid practical openings?
I don't think so, because when I'm playing here in Denmark, I'm often playing a lot older guys.
Interesting.
So I'm not like I hear from the States that you play a lot of young kids, and I think of the games I've played, I've played young kids maybe two or three times. But I think it's because I play the evening games that when on Tuesday evening they can last to midnight, so that's maybe not as good for kids as well as adults, but for kids maybe not so good when you have to go up to school next day.
Yeah, so that's how you avoid playing the kids.
Yeah. You pick odd playing times.
Yeah, okay. That's a good pro tip right there. But philosophically, where do you feel about...
Personally, I prefer the positional sound approach compared to the wild variations where you have to memorize stuff. I like the freedom maybe to put my own ideas into the game, while the very sharp variations can get a bit confusing. But I don't think it's because I'm old. I just think it's a part of my personality.
Yeah, I mean, to give my two cents, I also feel like you mainly have to follow your heart, but you shouldn't, I don't think one should avoid tactics per se just because they're old, but or older, over 30, which is not old. But I do think you might need to make some concessions in terms of your repertoire as you get older. For example, I was playing the Open Sicilian for a while, and I've been trying to plug holes left and right in my opening repertoire, and something had to give. So I'm playing like the Moscow and the Rosolimo. against the Sicilian. Like, and it's not in a perfect world, I would still keep it real with the open Sicilian, even though maybe it's not best for my results, but I just find the games fun. But if I'm going to know any theory, to me, it's just too overwhelming. It's just too much theory when you've got, you know, all the other aspects of your repertoire to learn as well. So that's just my personal perspective. But I do think playing sharp lines is okay if that's what you like. What were you going to say, Martin?
Yeah, I can maybe add that at the moment I've won or drawn my last 10 or 11 over the board games, which I'm quite happy about. But the game that I last lost was because I decided before the game to switch playing meet the e4 with the e5. And I suddenly got a King's Gambit on the board.
Oh,
and
boy, yeah.
Suddenly I was just, after I think 7 or 8 moves, I was just into a completely messy position, and I didn't like it at all. And then I lost the game. And then I just switched back to what I played before. But so my advice is not to to switch stuff just before a tournament game.
Yeah, despite
had experience about that.
Yeah, despite my friend Jan Gustafsson's trash talk about the King's Gambit, you still need to have some clue what you're doing in these openings, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So Arjun, I hope this was helpful. It's obviously a lot to decide on when designing an opening repertoire, but yeah, hopefully you found some useful advice. But don't sell out too much. I get tempted too, as I've mentioned on Twitter and on the podcast a couple times. I'm always tempted to switch to old man chess, as Ben trademark goes to Ben Feingold on that as well. But I think it's better to follow your heart. So we've got a question related to time management, not game time management, but lifetime management. But before we hop into that, Martin, we are going to hear from our aforementioned friends at Chessable.
As always, Perpetual Chess is proud to be brought to you in part by Chessable.com. Chessable is a chess learning website that utilizes its Move Trainer technology to help you learn and remember opening lines, tactical patterns, and endgames. It is endorsed by GM Magnus Carlsen and features courses from IM John Bartholomew, Sam Shanklin, Wesley So, and so many others. Chessable has over 100,000 members and features hundreds of courses both for free and for purchase. So if you haven't checked it out yet, please go to chessable.com and take a look around. Back to the interview.
Okay, so Martin, this Patreon question is from another friend of the online chess community, especially active on chess Twitter, and fellow working father, Peter Newhall. So Peter asks, how does an adult improver with 3 kids stay motivated and inspired? Have you experienced much burnout or fatigue in terms of having such an ambitious hobby?
Yeah, I it's definitely a challenge. My kids are aged 2, 6, and 8, and there's a lot to do. Sometimes when they are put to bed, you are tired and the house is needing a major cleaning, and when you're done with that, it can be difficult to convince yourself to study chess or maybe play the long game you have arranged online. But somehow I've managed to keep up motivation, and I think it's I haven't burned out on chess, but I've burned out of on different study plans, and I've made a lot of training schedules, and I tried there was an experiment on Puzzle Rush where you had to do that day in and day out for as much as that you can bear take in, and after thinking 14 days with Puzzle Rush, I was burned out on that, and I've done so with different training ideas I had through the time that, okay, now I'm tired of this study method and I want to do something else. So I haven't burned out on chess, but sometimes I need to switch things up.
It's tough. I mean, Peter and Peter's kids, I believe, are around the same age. I know he's got at least one who's daycare age. I believe more than one. And yeah, it's hard. And I'm in a similar boat. I mean, what I've managed to do in the past year is do at least a little bit each day. But I'm no Neil Bruce when it comes to the chess study, and it's just tough. I mean, you know,
my main difficulty is getting enough time to play over the board games because when my youngest daughter was a little smaller, she would fall asleep before I could get to the game, drive to the games, and I could just reach in time before the clock started. But as she's now 2 years old, she is falling asleep a little bit later, and now I suddenly can't get her to sleep, and my kids are just hard to get to sleep. So it's a really big task to do it as one parent. So I can't really ask my wife to do this every week for 7 or 11 weeks in a row. So I need to be a little bit more patient with getting the games in and trying to get my rating up further. So that's my main difficulties with getting everything done.
Yeah, it's really hard. I mean, and I know you've been really good about taking games seriously online, which is a great substitute, because I'm in a similar boat. I've been saying, when quarantine is over, I'm going to play tournaments, and I'm excited in theory to play tournaments, but that's without having had any of the conversations with my wife about, oh, by the way, I'm thinking about these Sunday tournaments, like, oh, by the way, how would you feel if every Sunday for, you know, once a month on every Sunday, I just bounce at 11 in the morning and I'll see you at 8 o'clock at night. Now, she's loving and understanding. I think she'll be okay with it, but you don't know. And like, certainly like there might be months where that's an issue. And with any weeknight thing, that would be even harder given where I live, because I'm not like in a major metropolis. So yeah, online games can be so much easier. So do you find it? And the good thing about online games is, okay, like you might be like slowing your timeline down in terms of like whatever rating goals you have in mind. But if your actual chess is improving, it doesn't matter. Like it'll, you know, the rating will catch up to the improvements you make. But that's if you can take the online games as seriously, which gets to my question. So can you?
Yeah, I've played the 15 plus 15 games on Light Chess, a good part, but sometimes you don't know the person and you get in, run into cheaters, and it can really take your energy when you invest maybe 1 hour, 1.5 hour on a game, and then it was against an Indian. So I try to organize tournaments on Twitter. It started, I can't remember when the first tournament started, but I just threw the idea out on Twitter to if anybody was interested in playing a tournament. And there was, I think we were about 24 players for the first Twitter chess tournament. We played the tournament and we got to know each other and then people were also kibitzing the other tournament games and I think I would like to give that advice to try to if you have on a social network or something where you can get spectators on the games while you're playing, because then you are putting pressure on yourself to take it serious, because you know people are watching. You can't embarrass yourself, And I think that's great. You can also stream your games on Twitch. This is another way to put this pressure on yourself to take it serious, because very easily you can get distracted and open another browser and stuff like that if you're just playing against a random person.
Yeah, so, it's tough. But on the other hand, like I gave a shout out to the Twitter chess tournament. Thank you for organizing those, by the way. But like when you see that people are watching, to me, that itself is distracting. Like even more so than like if you're in a tournament hall, someone walks by, you know, you may notice, you may not. But for Lead Chess or whatever, when it has their names and stuff, like for me, I found that itself distracting. And right. I know, like you say, there's of course issues with cheating and stuff like that. So it's online chess definitely has its unique set of challenges.
Yeah, because I think the third tournament we did where I think about 130 persons joined the tournament, and a lot of them were anonymous, and we didn't have any idea about who the people were who joined the tournament, and there were some bad apples, and I ended up using a lot of time dealing with these issues, and that took a lot of the joy out of it for me. So I have tried to play people I now know on Twitter, and also from the Chess JoJo, where you can also find some serious players also.
Yeah, Chess Dojo does their ladder games, and they're doing like a Sunday thing too, right?
Yeah, where you can get your games commented on. But it's a little bit late for us Europeans, but I think they have been talking about doing another show for the European crowd, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, they give so much to the improver community, so it's definitely good to take advantage of all that the Chess Dojo offers. So with time management, I mean, the amazing thing is like, okay, you're working, you've got the three kids, and you've done these, and you're working to improve your own game, but you've also done these content projects. I mean, you've got your blog, which obviously there's some overlap with improvement, because the act of writing and annotating may help you improve. But the YouTube channel, the Twitter chess tournament, we'll get to your book, of course. And you were the one doing the chess book reviews site too, right?
Yeah, that's correct. I started a webpage with the idea to make a book reviews site with a focus on chess books, because I think both on your podcast, but also on Twitter and other sites, use a lot of time discussing chess books, which is the best for which rating groups, and which one has the best annotations and stuff like that. But there isn't really one place where you can go and rate your chess books. And I thought, okay, I will try to do this and see how it goes. And I think I've got pretty close on making a site that was functional, but I think I was lacking a little bit of the abilities. It would have been good to have some professional helping me with the project. But so I decided to close it down, because I wouldn't use all my time on it, and I would rather use my time studying chess. So. It was a good idea, I think, but I had to prioritize.
Yeah, exactly. I think it was really a nice idea, as I said at the time. I mean, you know, it'd be nice to rest ourselves from the tyranny of Jeff Bezos and Amazon. I mean, of course, they have reviews there, which can be helpful, but not everyone buys their books from there. And just, you know, other websites could use traffic as well. Other you know, sites could sell stuff as well. But totally understand you're needing to abandon that project. I was impressed that you even took it on to begin with, because it's not going to be like a big moneymaker. It was out of the kindness of your heart, and you have plenty going on besides that, which brings us to your book. So Martin's new book, I mean, he's been working on it, I know, for most of this year at minimum. So the idea behind it, I think we should let, actually, I think it's better if you explain, Martin. So yes. Tell us about this project.
Yeah, my book, really, the whole started as, again, as an idea I had, because I was searching for a book to improve my my visualization and blindfold chess, and I had this idea that there must be a book where you can just, there's no diagrams to look at, and you can just see, read the notation where the pieces are, and then you have to solve the study or the position. So I decided to, okay, I will look for this book, and I couldn't find anything. So I thought, okay, maybe I could. Then I tested some position on Twitter, and there was some really good engagement, I thought. And then I got the idea, maybe I could make this book myself. And then I decided to try it out. And now it's out in the Amazon store. And yeah, it's been amazing. And also a lot of work, I must admit.
Yeah. Yeah, well, Martin, you did a great job on it. I mean, so it's available in Kindle. It's also now available in physical book. And Martin actually gave away the book to people who subscribe to his email list. But I'll be buying a physical book as well, and maybe even giving it to a student or two, because it really is, I think you correctly identified a sort of gap in the marketplace. I mean, it's really a great way to train. And I've mentioned before that I didn't do much blindfold training when I was coming up as a player, and I feel like it's made me a weaker player as a result. So I've actually been doing the book some. I made a rule since the book came out that I'm not allowed to play Blitz online until I solve at least one of your puzzles. So I'm in a given day, so I'm lazy. So it usually does end up just being just one puzzle unless I get it right away. But, you know, that means I'm like 12 or 13 puzzles into the book, and it's beautifully presented. Martin, nice format. And then you do have the diagram on the second page. So if you're really struggling with a puzzle, you can still turn the page and see the diagram without necessarily looking at the answer. So kudos to you. It's really great that you undertook that project.
Thank you. As a club player, it is really. I was really nervous about sending a book out into the chess community, because it can be really a tough crowd. A lot of chess players is very serious about their hobby for good reason, and I think also how I did it with sending it out to all the people. I think it was about, I have 500 people signed up to the newsletter, receiving the book for free, as in a digital form, and I've gotten a lot of feedback from all those nice people sending back comments, and also some very strong players have helped me make the book even better from what I sent out. What's now available in paperback, and I tried to implement those comments I got from all the readers that received it for free. So I think that was a good decision from my part, because I also saw on Twitter that I think the chess historian Olympio Urkan said that he couldn't understand why a 1600 rated player could get a book published from a serious chess publisher. And I think I present this book as a club player, and I see, I present it as not an expert. I've made these puzzles and done the whole layout and solutions as to my best of ability, and think the result is pretty good. So, but I know there are some people who are really thinking, okay, it's only title players who can write chess books. But I hope I can make an opening for club players, and I know that at least two people has written to me and said that this has inspired them to push on with their own book projects that are chess related. So that was very nice to hear.
Yeah, that's great. And yeah, you're not, you know, as the author of this book, you're compiling studies that you think are appropriate for people to solve blindfold. You're not like Troitsky designing the study, you know? So, I mean, it's a great service to the improver community because you identified an exact thing that's needed, but yeah. You're not like presenting yourself as a grandmaster that's going to explain it. So.
And then there's also a process in the book that I can't solve myself blindfolded because, and I've also had emails from very strong players who said that one was a tough puzzle. So there's a little bit for everything and everybody in the book, I hope. So,
yeah, I've gotten a couple wrong already. and then a couple where you have it right, but maybe you missed one variation or something like that. And for anyone wondering, my personal opinion is anyone say 1400 to 2200, it's right in your wheelhouse. It's a great way to train blindfold. And I will, this is coming out after my book recap, but Martin, I think we discussed, I'll probably read a couple puzzles from your book at the end of the book recap of Simple Chess. So listeners, that's where that will be coming from. But I know that, you know, there's just, if you want to get better at chess, doing some work on calculation and visualization is kind of unavoidable. So that of course begs the question, Martin, did working on this book, do you feel like it helped your own visualization skills?
I would say I'd hoped it would help me more but the whole process of collecting these studies and how I discovered them, I couldn't sit for 30 minutes and visualize, and then if I didn't like that one, go to the next one. I had to look at the position, and I think I've went through about 300 to 500 studies, maybe more, and positions just to, and then I got down to about 100 puzzles, positions, and then I just picked the best for the 50 in the book. So the whole that process would have been impossible if I had tried to solve it all by myself as a part of the training. I hope like in maybe half a year to a year when the whole is sift down a bit, I can pick out my book and then I can try to redo the whole book and check myself. That's at least my hope.
Yeah, it's like spaced repetition too, because you have some familiarity with the puzzles. And of course, some of them are classics. So a few of them, I was like, oh man, I know I've seen this puzzle, but I still can't quite put my fingers on the answer in some cases. But great stuff. I definitely recommend it for anyone in the rating range I mentioned, or if you just want to support Martin's work. These books are quite inexpensive. How much is the physical? How much are they?
It's only $10, so I think it's perfect for if you are going to, when the world gets opened up again, if you're going to travel, and you can it's a small format, so you can bring it on your next trip, I hope.
Yeah, and even cheaper in ebook.
That's $5, I think.
Yeah. So definitely listeners, check that out and, get grinding on your blindfold skills. So Martin, just one or two more things before we get you out of here. I just was hoping you could synthesize sort of the main things you've learned about chess improvement, in your recent years studying.
I would say that one thing think that it's not mentioned that much that I think made a huge difference for me was looking at pawns and pawn structures. I spent a good share of time on studying those pawn endings and trying to get those down. And I used the course called Mastering Pawn Endgames by Ahmed Al-Khatib, I think it is, on Chessable. And that's an excellent course to work on for pawn endings. And also chess structures. I enjoyed that book.
Yeah.
And also got very inspired by Pump Up Your Rating by Alex Smith, which also have an element of pawn levers and how to use those in your games. So, and I noticed in after working on those, I noticed in some over the board games, I was able to convert losing positions to winning in games just in the pawn endings. So
yeah.
So that has been a huge improvement with my chess, at least to work on those. And also just playing a lot of longer games is one thing I want to keep doing. And I also read the book Atomic Habits by James Clear. Which I want to recommend also to those who asked about how to get more time into your daily lives. Just trying to look at your daily routines and try to, he has used an idea of like the 1% improvements in everyday things. Maybe it's not a much you did that in, but it's collective. It will give an effect on your chess. Like, I've tried to, used the sleep reminder on my iPhone that pops up when I'm playing online that now it's time to go to bed and try to get some sleep. And also I've tried to more evenings. I like beer. A previous hobby I had. I have been brewing beer. I've tried to, for some meals in the evening, just to buy a non-alcoholic beer because I knew I was going to study chess and stuff like that, trying to maximize the time you have available.
I know some other members of the chess community are big fans of Atomic Habits by James Clear, like Geert Vandervelt and I believe Neil Bruce are tweeting about it a lot. I'd read some other habits books, so I was like, oh man, do I have to read another habits book? Like, the third one. So I haven't pulled the trigger yet, but I know you guys are strong advocates. So at some point I'll probably read it.
But I guess he's not like inventing anything new, but he's just presenting it in a very eatable way that also inspires you to make some changes. So it can be a good book to buy in January when you want to restart everything and look with on your chest with new eyes, I think.
Yeah, man. Well, I gotta lose this quarantine weight. That's the habit I need to work on.
Yeah, definitely. Also, getting some exercises is something that can help on your chest.
Excellent. So you recommend, you gave a few good book recommendations, the King and Pawn course on Chessable, chess structures, and what was the third one? I'm sorry. Axel Smith, Pump Up Your Rating. Who is also, of course, known for the Woodpecker Method.
Yeah.
Play training games online. Obviously, you interface with a lot of people online, which I think helps build community and, as you say, helps hold you accountable. So good stuff. I mean, it's great to see your progress. And again, listeners, if you're in the rating range and you're trying to improve your visualization, I promise you Martin's book is a worthwhile, tiny little investment. So Martin, I know you mentioned you're going to be slowed down from playing tournaments more than you would like, but my last question for you is what your goals are in the coming year, especially as it relates to chess, but even beyond chess.
I think my goal is since there's still so much uncertainty in the current world, and I don't know how and when I can, how much I can play over the board, which is my main focus, and I still prefer that over playing online. I will try to focus my goals on what I can manage myself, and by doing that, I want to next year work on master games. I've bought Alekhine's Greatest Games collection, and it's my plan to go over them on Twitch, my Twitch channel. I did have done this in the autumn, where I look at Ben Larsen's games, and everyone who comes in can analyze the games together with me during the stream, and it's been quite fun and also a motivating way to look at those master games together with other players. So I would just that's one goal for next year, is to go through this book. As a second goal, I want to keep playing longer games. I played a good share of rapid games, but I also want to play some more longer games, 45 plus 30 seconds games online.
Good. I like that your goals aren't just tied to, like, I'm going to get to X rating. It's like, I'm going to do this thing and I'm going to do this thing.
I can maybe say that when I started my YouTube channel in it was in March 2019, I set the goal to be an FM Finemaster in 5 years, and it's still my most watched video.
Right.
But I soon realized that maybe it's a little bit unrealistic with having three kids and not the possibility to play as many games that I need to get to that level. So I have adjusted it to say I want to reach 2,000 feeder rating as my current goal.
That's great. Yeah, and I think you'll be there. That's, you know, you're knocking on the door, I would think. Again, no one knows the exact conversions of the Elite Chess rating, but within spitting distance, if nothing else.
At least my performance rating over the last games has been 2,100. So I hope with more games I can reach my goal.
Yeah, that's great. And that also underscores what I'm always preaching about, just one goal at a time. You know, people don't need to set these super distant goals. It's okay to have like a stretch goal secretly in your mind, but it's hard enough to gain 100 points, let alone 500. So
yeah.
Cool. Well, Martin, thank you for all your contributions to the chess learning community. It's really I still, even after interviewing you, I still don't know how you find the time, but we appreciate it nonetheless.
Oh, and thank you, Ben, and thank you for having your podcast. And I would just like to say to all the listeners, go support Ben on Patreon.
Oh, that's nice of you to say. I appreciate that. And I'll get the links to everything. I'll get the links to everything. So Twitch, YouTube, the book, Twitter, anything beyond those four, Martin?
Oh, I think that's enough.
Okay. So yeah, listeners, give Martin a shout. And Martin, congratulations on your success. And keep it up.
Thank you, Ben.
Thanks, as always, to my producer, Matthew Passy, and to everyone who helps spread the word about the show, telling your friends, writing positive reviews on podcast platforms. All of that stuff helps. You can follow me on Twitter. I'm at BennyFishel1. Join the Perpetual Chess Facebook group. You can find the link on the website. And we are back in action on Instagram, at Perpetual Chess, sharing a weekly clip from the podcast. So follow us over there as well. But of course, the main purpose of these credits is to thank everyone who makes the show possible by their financial support. Without you all, Perpetual Chess would have ceased to exist a long time ago. And for that, I am forever grateful and work to continually improve and expand the offerings from Perpetual Chess. So without further ado, I would like to give extra special thanks to the following people and entities: Chessable.com, David Lazarus of LazmanChess.com, Quality Chess Books, the Capital City Chess Club, the Abysmal Deaths of Chess blog, Adapta Interactive Web Designs and Services, the Apprentice Twitch channel, Andrew Alharji, Andrew Bach, Aniti Deer,
Boston Clough, Benjamin Porteau, Bill Sigler, Kathy Carr, Chad Oliver, the Charlotte Chess Center, the Chess Central's Chess Blog, ChessMood.com, Chris Flanagan, Chris Lott, Dan O'Hanlon, Daniel He, Danny Davidson, David Schreiber, Derek Jones, I am Dimitri Schneider, I am Eric Rosen, Eric Tam, Ewan Richardson, Farhan Thawar, Faraz Sawaf, Gary Foreman, Glenn Downing, Greg Harfs, Greg Shahade, Gregory Gulick, Guvin Manet, James Kennedy, Jeff Martinson, Jens Green, Jeremy Nielsen, John Jernigan, John Rockefeller, John Cromartie, John MacArthur, Kelly Palmer, Kevin O'Callaghan, King Selt, Lucio Casada Silva, the Law Offices of Stuart Katz, Matthew Feeney, Michael Kahn, FM Michael Oblin, Mike Zelazny, Mr. Mike Shahade, the famous Mr. Dodgy, the NerdNaze Twitch channel, Peter Sodi, the Playmore Chess Academy of the Hampton Chess Club, Reuven Fischer, the Seattle Chess Club, Shane Unger, Stephen Kelty, Stephen Martinez, Thomas Stanix, Thomas Tachenko, Todd Bryan of StrongChess.com, Todd Kennedy, the Vintage Patzers, which is a Chess.com improver group, Wayne Beam, William Hogarth, Aaron Waffler, Ace Viega, Adam Ralph of ChessEngland.com, Adrian Gutierrez, Alex Payhouse, FM, Andre Tarakov, Dr. Andrew Perry, Barry Hessian, Bill Juniper, Bill Moran, Brad and Andy Rosen, Brett Howard Lynn, Brian Mullis, Bruce Scott, Brian Dillis of Palm Beach Chess, Chad Hilton, Dr. Charles Snodgrass, Chris Wayne Scott, Christopher Baumgartner, Christopher Shabri, Christopher Wood, I am Christoph Zalecki, aka Chess Explain, Coach J's Chess Academy, Corey Budson, Costa Corus, Courtney Fry, Craig Mallon, Daniel Ginsberg, Daniel Naylor, Dave Saylor, David Bleskacek, David Brown, David Hamblin, David Cramley, Dalen Shelton, Dennis Parrish, Dirk Decker, FM Donnie Ariel, Douglas Matthew, Dwayne Edmonds, Ed Daly, Emmanuel Langlois Robitaille, Ethan Smith, Hallelujah Cat, Ian Mason, Indrik Ryland, Felipe Melo Pereira, Fox Valley Chess Club, Francis Letart Lavoie, Dr. Frank Tortoise, Frank Zananis, Gary Andrews, Gary Lewis, Geert Vandervelt, Gene Stewart, Gerard Barta, Giovanni Russo, Hans Schutt, Harish Srinivasan, Howard Vihan, Jacob Kovacs, Jacob Turan, Jacques Perry, James Espinwall, James Bonastia, James Muir, Jason Willem, J.D. Chakrabarty, Jeff Anderson, Jeffrey Martello, Yep Hoyland, Jerry Wells, Jim Ratliff, John Tully, Juan Almaguer, Dr. John Fallon, John Fernandez, John Fontaine, John Hartman, John Jeffrey, John McMurtry, Jonathan Slater, John Tully, Jose Rodriguez, Justin Gardner, WGM Jen Shahade, Joel Rocky, John Thompson, Grandmaster Josh Friedel, I am Kare Christensen, WGM Katerina Nemsova, Kelly Palmer, Kevin Boyce, Kevin Pryor, Kior Gada of the Lakeshore Chess Club, I am Kostya Kavutsky, Krishna Gopala Krishnan, Kyle McAvoy, Larry Reiforth, Laura Belyovsky, Macaulay Peterson, Mark Miller, Martin Knudsen, Martin Krug, Matthew Passy, Matthew Tedesco, Matthias Plock, the Mechanics Institute Chess Club of San Francisco, Michael Allard, Michael Hudson, Miguel Araspidi, Mike Clem, Mitchell Fabian, Nate Salon, Neil Bruce, Nigmat Malajanov, Nicholas Isabel, Olaf Mueller Michaels, GM Pascal Charbonneau, Passy Passanen, Paul Bain, Paul Clarkson, Paul Sweeney, Paulo Santana, Peter Lux, Randy Tempo, Ricky Grijalva, Richard Hallenbach, Robert Tichy, Robert Turner, Rory Coleman, Rory Yearwood, Ryan Berg, the Say Chess YouTube channel, Scott Doherty, Scott McKinnon, Sebastian Finsterwater, Walder, Shane Unger, the Silver Knights in Richmond, Stefan Roller, WGM Tatia Vabrahamian, Tim Brennan of TacticsTime.com, Tim Seymour, Timothy Ha, Tom Edsel, Tomas Komanich, Tony Rotella, Tyron Price, Vishnu Srikumar, William H. Brock, William Juniper, William Peterson, FM Zhao Cheng of Chess1000.com, and of course, Zhivko Stoyanov. Thanks for listening, everyone. We will be back next week with another episode of Perpetual Chess.